Okay, thank you very much. I want to take this opportunity to welcome all of you to church. I miss every one of you, and we are so happy that we've been able to make it possible for you to come. And we thank God for every one of you that has made it here. God richly bless you. This morning, I'm speaking on the subject, how to defeat the Goliath in your life. How to defeat the Goliath in your life. How to defeat the Goliath in your life. This is a story that is, we all know, everybody that have been to Sunday school, you know it. We are all taught. Yes. How to, it's 1 Samuel chapter 17. And so how to defeat your Goliath. The first point is this. Let me say this for some of you. If you get to a point and you are finding it difficult to breathe, just put it on your chin like this. Listen to me. What we have done is beyond all the recommendation in the whole world. The government gave 1 meter. We did 2 meters. Here is 3 meters. The person beside is 3 meters. So it's way, way beyond. Way, way beyond. We fumigated this place yesterday. The first service, when we finish, we have sanitizers that they came to rub all the seats that you sit on. Everything that we have done, you can't get it anywhere in Ghana. Not even in Parliament. Not even in Parliament. So I want you to be rest assured. Are you hearing me? No, I did it for the world to know that this place is safer to come to than to go to the market. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Yes. So that those of you who don't know, that's why. We have physical Goliath. Who is Goliath? Who is Goliath? That is it. Quickly. Who is Goliath? We have physical Goliath and spiritual Goliath. The physical Goliath means that we had somebody whose name was Goliath in the Bible. And the Bible says that he was representing the armies of the Philistines who were coming against the Israelites. And the Bible tells us that this Goliath is between 6 and 9 feet tall. Between 6 and 9 feet tall. Is there anybody here who is 6 feet? 6 feet. If you are 6 feet, stand and then we'll see. Then we'll add 3 to your, so that they will see how it is. Okay. Martin is 6 feet. So it means that Goliath was more taller than Martin. So add 3 more feet to Martin. So you add half of Martin. You add half. That's how Goliath is. Thank you. And the Bible says that the armor he was wearing, that it weighs 125 pounds. If you have checked your weight, you see. So somebody that can have 125 pounds weight on him and can still walk and lead the army, it means that the person is really a giant. He's huge and tall. So spiritually, what does Goliath stands for? Spiritually, Goliath stands for any giant problem you have. Any giant problem you have is Goliath. Anything that stands on your way of achieving what God wants you to achieve is Goliath. Anything that makes you afraid, because the Bible says that anytime the Israelites saw Goliath, they were all frightened. So anything that makes you afraid is Goliath in your life. You know, there are some of us, when night is approaching, then our heart is beating us, because you know what is going to happen in the night. And some of us, it's true. Any problem you have and is pestering your life, is challenging you day and night, and the problem is speaking to you. Goliath was speaking to the Israelites every day, and they were frightened. You can get global Goliath. Right now, the global Goliath that we are all fighting, that is making us fear, is coronavirus. Coronavirus has brought fear to everyone, including Christians. That there are some who will say, go and see whether if it's safe, I will come. But I will let you know. So, we have medical Goliath. We have marriage Goliath. We have economic Goliath. We have different types of Goliath. Every one of us. Any problem that you face, the Goliath. Then that leads me to my second point. Everyone will face Goliath in his or her life. Everyone. Everyone will face something that will challenge you. Everyone will face something that is going to challenge you. That will make you, that will intimidate you. That will make you fear. That will make you crawl and then go into your shell. Everyone will face something like that. I'm telling you, whether you are a bishop, whether you are a pastor, whether you are whatever it is, now all of us are facing this coronavirus. Everybody. And it's making people afraid. And it's not making people even not to go to church. Are you hearing me? And I'm going to talk about that. So John 16:33. I have told you this so that you will have peace by being united to me. The world will make you suffer, but be brave. I have what? Defeated the world. Jesus said, I am warning you in advance. You are going to have so many Goliath, but be rest assured, I've overcome the world. The Message Bible. I have told you all this so that trusting me, you will be what? Unshakable. And what? Assured. Deeply what? At peace. In this godless world, you will continue to experience difficulty. Did he say we will face it once? Or say you will continue. After this virus, another one will come. They've already said it. So he said, you will continue to have the bet. Take heart. I have what? Overcome the world. The good news for we Christians is that we have a God. Are you hearing me? We have a God. Now let me go to the third point. Behind every Goliath is a demonic spirit. And that's what I want to agree. Behind every Goliath, any giant problem you face in your life, there's a demonic spirit behind it. Telling you, any Goliath you face, there's a demonic spirit behind it. Ephesians 6:12. What does it say? For we are not fighting against human beings, but against the wicked spiritual forces in the heavenly world, the rulers, authorities, and cosmic powers in the dark age. This world is under the domain of the devil. And let me tell you, you don't need anybody to tell you that coronavirus is demonic. Sickness that will not even allow you to hug your cousin, your friend. Sickness that doesn't allow you to shake somebody's hand. Do you need anybody to come and tell you that this is demonic? Sickness that it does not even allow you to come to church. It doesn't want you to meet together. Do you need somebody to tell you that it's demonic? But listen to me. You see, sometimes the devil will make you fear, afraid of something that you are not supposed to be afraid of. Sometimes the devil will make you be afraid of something you are not supposed to be afraid of. And I'm going to show you now. Because this is the trick of the devil. And I want to reveal the trick of the devil. Let me ask you, everybody, be honest. How many of you, since the coronavirus started, that you have gone to town? If you have gone to town, raise up your hand. Okay, good. Hands down. How many of you have gone to the bank? Raise up your hand. I've been to the bank. Okay. How many of you have gone to the market? Market to buy things. Okay, good. How many of you have gone to the hospital? Yes, we have doctors here. Yes, they will tell you. Good. How many of you have sat in taxi? Taxi. Okay. Trotro. Okay. Let me ask you a question. Be honest with me. All the places that I've mentioned, the market, the bank, the trotro, the taxi, even the hospital, which is more safer to go than this place? Which is more safer to go than this place? And yet, listen to me, and yet you have faith to go to the market. You have faith to sit in the taxi unsanitizing. You have faith to go and make it to the banker. There is no distancing at the bank. Okay, at what? Next. Even the hospital. Hospital will be okubioyare. Listen to me. Even doctors and nurses have faith to go that place is more risky. They have faith to go every day. But coming to church with all this space, there be enya bonsam. Maybe some enya bonsam ana. Enya bonsam. It is bonsam because it is more safer to come here than to go to church, than to go to the market. And yet the devil has blinded us. He has blinded us that, look, I myself, last week, I was going to Republic Bank at Edum. The traffic there, so I parked at Opoku Trading and I taught my max. When I walk and came, I can never count the people who bump into me, shaking, getting this, getting that. And when I went, I look at it. Even there, Veronica Bucket, I want to show you. Obia Kwanu Asum, a whom feed Seminar Kubiliho. And I look at the way they were. I say, so what are they so fussy about church? What are they for? That's why I'm telling you that. Tell me, even in Parliament, do they have this space? When they were doing the auditing the new judges that they were taking, Supreme Court, didn't you see it on the TV? Did you see? How many of you saw it on the TV? Please, you see, if you are not careful, the devil will steal your faith. Now they have made it as if it is dangerous, but this is more safer to come. So if you have faith to go to town and you believe you will not catch the virus, then this place you must have more faith. If not, the devil is working on you. You have been deceived. It's time. Now, some of you, Menko. You see, let me tell you. When David wanted to kill Goliath, who were the people who discouraged him? His own brothers. And then he was even going to kill the Goliath. That was not David's problem. It was Saul's problem. And also discouraging. Mebwa. Look, you are going to face the challenges and the Goliath in your life. If you listen to people, you will never be able to conquer your Goliath. If you listen to the world, you will never. Let me go to the third point quickly. How did David kill Goliath? And that's what I'll talk about. And then I'll bring. How did David kill Goliath? And that's what I'm going to tell. It's very, very important. I'll tell you. How did David kill Goliath? 1 Samuel 17, 26, and 36. Give me 1 Samuel 26, and I'll read it. And then I'll read 36 and explain to you. Good. Then David spoke to the men who stood by him, saying, "What shall be done for the man who kills these Philistines and take away the reproach from Israel? For is who is this what? Uncircumcised Philistine." I've underlined it. I'll come to it. "That he should defy the armies of the living God." Then verse 36. "Your servant has killed both lion and bear. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, seeing he has defied the armies of the living God." The uncircumcised Philistines was used twice. The word defy was used also twice in this verse. When you read the Bible, we have something we call the law of repetition. Anytime something is repeated, it means take attention, because there's something important. It's like Jesus saying, "Verily, verily, I say unto you." Listen, David came. He saw the same thing the Israelites were seeing. He saw it. But he saw something also different, what the Israelites were not seeing. 2 Corinthians, give me the 2 Corinthians 4:18. Give me the 2 Corinthians 4:18. What does it say? "For we fix our attention not on things that are seen, but on things that are unseen. What can be seen lasts only for a time, but what cannot be seen lasts what? Forever." We fix our eyes not on things seen. So David came, he saw the giant Goliath, but he saw something which the other Israelites did not see. Look at it. When you look at Goliath, tall, huge, and everything, and he realized that this man was not circumcised. What is the big deal about circumcision? Give me Genesis 17. Give me Genesis 17. "This is my covenant which shall keep between me and you and your descendants. After you, every male child among you shall be circumcised." 11. "And you shall be circumcised in the flesh of your foreskin, and it shall be a sign of what? It shall be a sign of the covenant between me and what? You." This word was spoken to Abraham, isn't it? When he entered into a covenant with God, and God said, "This covenant I'm entering into is for you and your descendants. And the sign of that covenant is that anybody that comes and wants..."